Good day, brothers and sisters. I'd like to welcome you to JCC Sunday School's In Session, where Sunday School matters to God. Please like and leave us a comment. Also, subscribe to our channel. We'll love to have you as part of the JCC family. Our lesson is coming from Isaiah 9, verses 6 and 7, and John chapter 12, verses 12 through 16, and is entitled, A King Comes Forth. Today, our lesson is going to continue with the triumphant entry into Jerusalem. Christ will enter into the city, and we will learn the symbolism behind his entry. I tried to go to dive in a little bit deeper this week in our lesson to give you a deeper analysis of the lesson. I pray you enjoy it. Let's get into the lesson to see what it has to offer us this week. Verse 6 says, For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Question 1 and 2 asks, what is the first title given to the Messiah in Isaiah 9 and 6, and which of these titles is most remembered at Christmas? Wonderful Counselor and the Prince of Peace are the answer to these two questions. Notice these two names could be applied to a human, and the other two a deity. Could the prophet been trying to show us that the Messiah is fully God and yet still fully man? This is a very interesting concept. However, as we know, no ordinary man could ever hold all these names. No, only the one and true God, the one that is Christ himself, the one who was born of a virgin, the one who clothed humanity around his divinity. As we look at verse 6, though, it beckons us to go in and understand the names and what they mean to us. Wonderful in Hebrew means miraculous. As we define miraculous, it means this occurs through divine or supernatural intervention or one manifesting supernatural power. This shows us of his glorious power being miraculously shown as the Messiah. It was only the Messiah who came in and manifested supernatural power over the earth, over food, over sickness and disease. He manifested his way in a wonderful way. Counselor in Hebrew denotes one who is wise in counsel or one who provides wisdom, meaning to life, and purpose. This has to do with guiding or leading someone in the right direction. Christ is the one who will counsel to give us meaning and purpose to this life for God. Christ guided those when he came into the world and is the Holy Spirit who will guide us into all truth now. Mighty God comes from the Hebrew word El. It is used only for God Almighty. This is saying Christ will be the Emmanuel. He will be God with us. He will be the Almighty God with us. He took on the form of man to be found a servant, yet he remained God Almighty. For this reason, we can see the love and personal concern for God for his people. Aren't you glad that we serve a God who loves us so much, who's willing to come down and save us, to be among us, to dwell among us in order to save us? To God be the glory. Everlasting Father, this name speaks for itself. He's everlasting and eternal. Christ told us in John 10:39 that he and the Father are one when Philip asked him to see the Father. Christ was saying, if you were looking at me, you're looking at the Father, for we are one. But Father also means, when it says everlasting Father, Father also has a meaning as well. It means protector. Christ says, when we are in his hands, no man can pluck us out. A family looks to his Father to protect it. And when we look to our Heavenly Father, he protects us as well. Putting all this together, we see Christ as the founder and protector of eternal life and all who belong to him. No one gets eternal life except through Jesus Christ. And finally, Prince of Peace. This speaks of Christ as a peace giver. He provided peace with God for our sins. Paul said in Romans 5:1, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Christ provides that peace with God, with man, and with other nations. He is the Prince of Peace. From this, we see Jesus is the King who meets all our needs. He meets each and every need as our Wonderful, as our Counselor, as our Mighty God, the Everlasting Father who ushers us into eternal life, and our Prince of Peace. We have it all in him. In Jesus Christ, he encompasses everything we need to be all that God wants us to be. Verse 7, of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from the henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Question 3 says, what are two qualities mentioned in verse 7 that will characterize the Messiah's reign? We learn through verse 7, Christ will rule with judgment and justice. Please allow me to provide an exposition. It's verse 6 and 7 right here. He says here, for unto us a child is born. This shows us his purpose for coming. And that purpose of Christ coming was for us. He came to save us all. Let no one tell you you don't have value. Christ loves you so much, he left divinity to put on humanity to die so that we might be saved. That makes you special right there. It says, unto us a son is given. He came from eternity. God planned to give him. John 3 says, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. He gave his son that we might live. Jesus, yes, he is the Son of God. He is, and it shows that personal relationship between Father and Son. So God desires to have that same relationship with us as well as sons and daughters of God. It says, and the government will be upon his shoulder. Jesus will reign as king. The government of the entire world will be upon his shoulder. He will rule this here world. When he came here, he came in a miraculous way. He was a wonder to us all. He came in a way that was supreme above anyone else. His name is Wonderful because he is wonderful. And his name will be called Counselor. Jesus reveals to us the mind of God. He counsels from God's perspective. He gives God's counsel to us all. And it says, and his name will be called Mighty God. He is God Almighty. In him dwells all the fullness of the deity in bodily form. And his name will be called Everlasting Father. He is the Father of eternity, everlasting in life and in him because he is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the gatekeeper to eternal life and all the while maintaining his status as Father, our protector. And his name will be called Prince of Peace. Peace will be characterized here on earth as he reigns upon the earth. This peace will surpass all understanding. Isn't he a great God? That he brings about peace. He brings about a calm in the middle of the storm. And of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end upon the throne of David and over his kingdom to order it and establish it with judgment and justice. From that time forward, even forever, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. We see a God made a covenant way back then with David. He made a covenant many years ago. And we see now that that covenant through David's bloodline is still coming alive. Although there may be turmoil in the world, although there may be confusion in the world, God still brings peace to those who believe. He gives us a peace that surpasses all understanding. He gives us an assurance that he's there to protect us. He lets us know that he brings about everything we need in every aspect and characteristic of his life. To God be the glory. Verse 12 and 13 read, on the next day, much people that were come to the feast when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna, blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord. Question 4 says, on what day of the week did Christ triumphantly enter Jerusalem? It was Sunday and what we call Palm Sunday. Notice how he won the hearts of the people. He met the people wherever they were at. What am I saying? He met them where they had a need. If they needed healing, he met them there. If they needed provisions, he met them there. If they needed deliverance from demons, he met them there. What am I saying? If you want to be like Jesus and win the people, if you want to win their heart, you have to meet them where they have a need. Watch this. The text says, when they heard he was coming to Jerusalem, they began to set things in motion. They took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him. The point is to make, why did God allow so many people to celebrate his arrival into the city? This is a prophecy of the coming rule of Jesus Christ here on earth. These verses gather into one prediction, one prophecy of his birth, his deity, his earthly government, his just kingship rule. Everything right here was culminating right here in this moment. This is the moment that he was to claim his throne. He was coming in to be the king, not to rule right now, but to do his triumphant entry into the city. Question 5 says, why were so many people in Jerusalem there at the time? It was a time of Passover. The Passover was a required feast for Jewish men. They had to come and participate in this feast. So the streets were filled, but when they heard Christ was coming, it was a special occasion for them as well. Ain't that funny? They just simply heard about Christ in the neighborhood. about his entry into the city, and they decided to come in and lay down palms before him. If we will go in and just tell the good news, tell the story of Jesus Christ, maybe somebody will allow him to be a triumphant entry into their lives as well. Question 6 says, how were palm branches signified in Jewish history? Palm branch was a symbol of triumph, of victory, peace, and eternal life. The palm branches are symbolic in that it is part of the Feast of Tabernacles. This was done to commemorate their liberation from Egyptian oppression by the hand of God by saying, staying in tents for 7 days. They celebrated this for the recognition of God's salvation, his shelter, his provision, and his trustworthiness. So the palm branches being laid during this time for the people was thought of gaining victory over physical oppression, again by Christ. Although Christ was bringing deliverance, this time it was in a form from the bondage of sin. It is also noted placing palm trees in the path of someone indicates royalty. They were acknowledging Christ as their new king, their new political leader, their new military leader to go in and bring forth them deliverance. As he rode the donkey, they shouted Hosanna. So what does question 7 and what does Hosanna mean? Hosanna means save me or save me now. It is shouted to one who can deliver another person. The people wanted deliverance from Romans. We may not have said Hosanna, but every child of God at one time or another has been in need of Christ saving you. And it's just like the same thing. When you realize you need Christ to save you from oppression, from sin, the bondage of sin, we may not say Hosanna, but we may say, Lord, save me. The point is, when God has been faithful, we cannot help telling others about Jesus and what he's done for us. Think about this. When God has been good to you, when God has made a way out of no way, when God has kept you, when God has protected you, when God has came in and showered favor upon you, you ought to tell somebody. You ought to tell somebody how good God has been to you. Question 14 and 15 says, and Jesus, when he had found a young ass, sat thereon, as it is written, fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, thy king cometh, sitteth on the ass colt. Question 9 says, what did Jesus ride on a donkey likely symbolize? This symbolized 3 things. The first one is the fulfillment of the prophecy in Zechariah 9:9, making this triumphant entry while riding lowly on an animal as a symbol of peace. Zechariah 9:9 prophesied, it states that this was a righteous and victorious entry. Even though he came lowly riding on a donkey, on a colt, on the foal of a donkey, this was right here showing us that how he would come in as a symbol of peace. The second thing, in ancient biblical world, a leader rode on a horse if he was coming in war, and a donkey to signify peace. The third thing that we can see in this right here, Jesus used the donkey to connect with the common people. The prophecy illustrates to us that people were not to be afraid. Why? He chose a donkey instead of a horse. Was God's way of saying that he came as a king who would serve and save the oppressed. The point I want to bring out right here is Jesus' example shows us the humility we are to demonstrate when we live out and proclaim the gospel. We're not to be puffed up, but humble. The Bible said God hates the proud and loves the humble. Let us always exemplify humility to demonstrate the love of Christ in us and the love of Christ for others. Verse 16 says, these things understood not his disciples at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then remembered they that these things were written of him, that they had gone these things unto him, and that they had done these things unto him. Question 10 says, why did Christ's disciples so often misunderstand him? They had not been given the Holy Spirit, who would guide them into all truth. We all need the Spirit to guide us, to speak for us, to make known the truth of God's word and God's plans for our lives. The point we want to make here, we will fully understand all the ways of God when the time is right. When the Spirit makes known them to us, for us, we will understand all the mysteries that are hidden from us. Deuteronomy 29:29 says, the secret things belong to the Lord our God, but the things revealed belong to us and to our sons forever, that we may observe all the word of his law. Well, we have seen Isaiah prophesy of God sending the anointed one to set his people free. And today, brothers and sisters, because he came, because of that triumphant entry, we are now free as well. Our part today is to trust in God's Messiah for the salvation of sin. It's only through Jesus Christ that we can be made whole. that we can be made free from the bondage of sin. We can see from the lesson, salvation came not but the way the people expected. And that's the problem many times, brothers and sisters. Many times when God doesn't meet our expectation, we get upset and we question God. But I challenge you today to keep the faith. Keep on believing. Keep on trusting in Him that God will make a way of escape, that God will bring us through these dangerous times. Well, God bless you all. I thank you for tuning in to another great lesson. I hope that you've enjoyed. If you have, leave us a comment. Give us a thumbs up. Come back next week, the same time, same channel. You all be blessed now.